algorithm. It starts with a random generation of a population, a set of, you can say, a population of a species, and then there is this evaluation function. For example, if a family is having certain kind of disease, maybe after 10 generations, due to the evolution, that disease can be taken out of the system. So that is the evaluation function. We'll evaluate that is this organ, is this feature in case of construction planning, is important for the optimization. Then we'll see the optimization criteria. Is our optimization criteria is met? For example, taking a very in a layman's language, suppose we are taking one of the column. For the non-civil people, column is nothing but the vertical structure of a building. The vertical, you can assume a building as a matchstick in which the vertical elements are columns and the horizontal ones are beams. So what is the most optimized size of a column? I mean, if you take in account the concrete and the reinforcement, a column having no reinforcement and no concrete will be the most optimized because its cost will be zero. But this might not be a practical solution. So optimization, meeting of the optimization criteria is the check we want to make. If it is happening in the first iteration, good and well, that will be our result. But if it is not, which is generally not happening in the first iteration, we'll iterate it again. We'll select some population, we'll select some species, some features from the population. We'll do a crossover, we'll do a mix and match of these features. And mutation is, suppose, again in layman's language, suppose there is a couple. The guy is having a blue eyes and the girl is having a brown eyes. The child will most probably have a blue or brown eyes, but there might be the case that the child can have a black eye. So that is what mutation is, and the probability of the mutation that we keep it in the algorithm is very less, which is like 0.0001. We'll again, after the mutation, we'll get a population, we'll again evaluate the function, and this will iterate. This is what is the system architecture of a genetic algorithm. Why construction planning? Construction planning is one of the most important aspects of in civil engineering, because everything in civil engineering is not about, in fact everything in engineering is not about the science, it is about the economics. So construction planning is very important. I can quote an example which will tell you how. So this is about a World Trade Center Path Station, which was originally priced to be $2 billion and was supposed to be slated to be completed in the starting of 2013. But because of some disruption in the supply chain of steel, the project was completed in the starting of 2014, and the net cost of the project shoot up to $4 billion, which is double of the cost. Moreover, this $2 billion is sufficient for making two stations in New York City and New Jersey. So if we have planned it properly beforehand, there might not be a loss of such a huge loss. So in genetic algorithm, we need something to optimize. So what are our objectives? The objectives during my research work is time, cost, job site movements. And let me tell you, the optimization is Pareto optimization, which is all three are dependent on each other. How job site is dependent? Suppose I have to install one column in a room, and column are, you can model it as a matchstick, but they are not exactly matchstick. So you need heavy machinery to move a column. So if I decided that I have to move the opposite column, I have to move a crane with it. And in a structure like Burj Khalifa, where there is 100 stories, if I'm working on 100 stories, the cranes with the wheels, which we generally see in our campus, is not used. The tower cranes are used, which itself are structure, which need to build and disintegrate it every time we are putting a column. direct, one is indirect. The direct cost consists of the cost of the aggregates, the cost of the cement, the cost of the steel, the cost of the labor. The indirect cost consists of the electricity cost, which no one takes into account. It also consists of the residential area which we are providing for the labor, the sanitary facilities, the drinking water facilities. That all comes under the indirect cost. So first I'll tell you what is the algorithm which we'll be using for the optimization of a project plan. So we'll start, we'll give a user input. There is a software known as BIM, it is building information modeling. That is nothing but it's an encyclopedia of a building. So it will consist of the 3D details of each and every element, starting from columns to foundations. And then it will also consist of a schedule. Schedule is nothing but the timetable which we generally use in day-to-day life. So that will give us a 3D model, and that will be our user input which we'll get from the BIM. Then we have this MOCC algorithm, let it be a secret. After that, we have this completed matrix of clusterability, that is MOCC. We'll put this matrix into the genetic algorithm, it will optimize, and we'll get a nearer optimum. So what is this MOCC? MOCC is matrix of clusterability constants. It is a matrix which is showing what are the constraints, what are my constraints when I'm building up. A building. The simplest example could be, if I want to put this roof over this room, I should have these columns settled over the ground. I cannot put the roof without the columns. This means that every activity in a project is dependent on another activity. Let's say A1, A2, AN are the activities. We can assume A1 is setting up a column and ground floor, A2 can be setting up of the beams, A3 can be setting up the slabs, A4 then again for the first floor, and so on. And SJI represent the dependencies. So we will go into the binary form, we will use 1 and 0. So suppose if S2, 6 is equal to 1, this means that activity 6 has a child relationship with the activity 2. For example, element 6 is a door and element 2 is a wall. Now we cannot make a door until unless we have a wall. So that is the relation which is deciding the constraints which will be taken care when we are running this algorithm. The next is the input, what we are going to give our input. So there are two things which we use for scheduling, that is CPM and PERT. PERT is a more probabilistic approach, and CPM does not take care of the probabilities. So this numbers can be assumed as activities. 5, 15, 10, 20, 25 are the they can be assumed as the events. So 5, 15, 10, 20, 25 are the events. For jumping from event 5 to event 10, I have to do some work. This is what is called activity. And the activity for sure will take some days. So the days are mentioned below the activity. Now there is this term known as dummy activity. Dummy activity is very useful during a scheduling, because as I have already mentioned that you need a column before setting up a beam, you need a foundation before setting up a building. So this dummy activity says that you have to do the activity 20 before activity 10, and the time period for a dummy is assumed to be 0. Time and cost relationship. So I'll give you two examples that will tell you that how time and cost are interrelated. The first is overtime. As we know that when we go for overtime, we have to pay more and increase the number of days. So suppose there are two costs. Suppose there is one cost for the residential area, for water and sanitary facilities of the laborers. And there is another cost which I am paying for the laborers for overtime. So suppose whatever I am paying for the overtime exceeds the cost that will be taken in care for their facilities if the number of days increases, I will surely not choose an overtime and may delay my project. So this is an example of how time and cost is related. And I will do this computation of machinery or providing some facilities for every activity in the previous schedule. The next is penalty versus overtime. So there is this type of project known as BOT project, which is build, operate and transfer. So generally when we are signing a contract for a project, you need to specify that we have to complete this project in XYZ period. Like our beta campus is supposed to be completed in 3 years or 4 years. And if you are not able to complete, in countries like in the countries of Middle East where there are huge constructions, they actually pay huge penalties. So if my penalty is too much in comparison to the surcharge of overtime, because if I tell the labor to do overtime, the time will decrease. So if the comparison of penalty and overtime is done and the penalty is supposed to be more than the overtime, then I obviously choose an overtime rather than giving a penalty. This is a graph which roughly shows how time and cost are related. So this blue line is the cumulative direct cost. And it can be very obviously seen that if a machine costs me $50 per hour and I will hire it for 100 days, its cost will surely be less than if I hire it for 50 days. That's how it's in straight line. This is the direct cost. The direct cost stands for the cost for materials, the cost for labor. And as you see that in the starting of the project, we surely need a lot of materials, which are the major cost of a construction project. And as we go on, the materials requirement will be less, the cost will decrease, at the end only the labor cost will be there. And if we sum both of this cost, we will get a total cost, and we can see that we are getting an optimal point, which is a critical time and a critical cost. So we have to find this optimum point. The next is job site movement. So you can assume it as a room. And this 1, 2, 3, 4, you can assume it as a room which I am seeing from a top view. These are the columns, 1, 2, 3, 4, and those are the beams which will be kept over these columns. So, suppose I have to put a beam and I have to hire a tower crane. So, how will, and the tower crane is costing me $100 per hour. So, how will I use my resources to minimize the cost by minimizing the job site movement? So initially, you can see that in both the figures, the activity is starting from this point. It is assumed that the lift or the conveyor, anything which will be used for the transportation at this side of the floor. So the first we decide to, at this span 1, we decide to make column 1, then column 2, 3 and column 4. Now it's time to put the beams. We start from the 8 because the materials will be carried through the conveyor and my conveyor is on this point. So I will go for beam 5. What should I do is I will go for beam 8. Then I will remove my tower crane and bring it here. I will assemble this beam 5. Then again I will remove my tower crane, I will bring it here, I will assemble it here. And again to the 7. What could be the another option? The another option is, let's put a beam here. Now let's put a beam here. Don't you think that the cost will increase if I move my tower crane from here to here rather than in cyclic order? So this is one of the things for the job site movement. This will not only reduce the time but also reduce the cost. So what is the recollection we can do from the project? We'll get our inputs from the input of schedules from the BIA. We'll put the input constraints and conditions using this those MOCCs. These are our constraints and the conditions will be what will be my labor cost, what will be my material cost and what my supply chain will be. Then we'll find the fitness function, that what is supposed to be the best. Like I gave an example of a column, that column with zero cost is the optimized but is not a fittest option to locate. After because we have three objective functions, we have three fitness functions. We'll use these three fitness function scores which will be calculated for each member and then it will be summed up to a single value to treat that multi-objective GA as a single objective GA. That's all. Thank you.